Hello everyone, welcome to a new devlog of my voxel survival roguelike RPG kind of game. The main topics I want to tackle are vertex compression to store more in less bits, new features and some optimizations. Our world is made out of a bunch of blocks. Each has its own information, but it doesn't matter if the player cannot see it. We have to convert this information of the world into something the GPU can handle and draw onto the screen. We want to send each block that we want to draw to the GPU, but we cannot tell the GPU to draw a cube. It's a little, not too much, more complex than that. The GPU renders triangles. Everything you see is made out of triangles. Why? Well, mainly because it's the simplest shape that is coplanar. A rectangle is a non-coplanar shape. That means that the four vertices of a square may or may not be in the same plane. But a triangle, on the other hand, is coplanar. So, to render a cube, as you may already know, we send to the GPU two triangles per face. And how do we send a triangle to the GPU? We send the three vertices of the triangle and how they connect. And that's everything we send to the GPU for each block. So we must ensure that every vertex has all the information we need to render the current state of the world. The basic information we must send is the position, the normal vector, and the texture coordinate. And here we must add the RGB light level. Now let's see how much bytes we need per vertex. The position and normal are 3D vectors of loads. So that's a total of 12 bytes for each. The texture coordinate is a 2D vector of floats, so 8 more bytes. And finally, the light level is 15 bits, so 2 bytes. These all add up to 34 bytes, which may not seem like a lot, but it quickly scales up when adding blocks, as each block can have up to 24 vertices, so we have to compress them as much as possible. Let's start with the first field in the list, the position. The chunks in the game are currently 16 by 128 by 16 blocks. We could store the X and Z axis into 4 bits each, and the Y axis in 7 bits. That would be enough if all the blocks were full cubes. But if we have different sized and shaped blocks, we must also store the decimals. For each axis, we'll need 6 bits. This way, we covered the range from 0 to 3 with the steps of 0.0625. We compressed the position down to 33 bits, compared to the 96 we needed previously. It's a considerable reduction. Let's continue with the normal vector. Here, we can take advantage of using voxels and reduce the 12 bytes to 3 bits only. The reason being is that our blocks only have 6 faces. So, 6 possible normals only. What we do here is to assign a normal vector to each number from 0 to 5, and we are done. Following the normal vector, we have to compress now the texture UV coordinates. Currently, the UV coordinates store the position in the whole texture atlas. To compress it, we'll send the texture ID instead in 2 bytes. But we have a problem. If we send only the texture ID, we need to specify somehow which vertex of the face is which corner of the texture. The first thing that came into my mind is to use the decimals from the position. But after implementing it, I quickly saw a problem. The blocks can be rotated. So there is no other way than also sending the UVs. The UV coordinates need only to be in the range of 0 to 1 this time, in steps of 0.0625, as the textures will be 16 by 16. In conclusion, the textures end up occupying 26 bits when previously 64 were needed. Lastly, there is the light level, but as it's already compressed in 15 bits, we leave it as it is. With all of these compressions, the total bits now needed is 77 bits. That's almost a 63% decrease, but unfortunately, the next smallest minimum amount of bits we can send to the GPU is 96. We have then 19 bits left, so I've used them to add some more details and features to our blocks. The first one is the wind. Some blocks now will be affected by wind, such as leaves. For this, only 1 bit is needed, indicating whether a vertex is affected by wind or not. Another feature I added is animated textures, without any meshing required. The way this works is by sending the number of frames a block has to play in a loop and the amount of ticks between each frame. I used 4 bits for the number of frames and 5 for the ticks between frames. This way we have animations up to 16 textures and the time between each frame can vary from 1 tick to 30. Last but not least, I implemented ambient occlusion. Ambient occlusion is a technique used to calculate how exposed a vertex is to the ambient light. In voxels, the corners of the cubes are darkened depending on the neighbor blocks. Every time a vertex is managed in the machine, we must check whether the blocks that affect that vertex are opaque or not. Let's take as an example this vertex. The blocks that must be checked are these three. And the code to compute the final ambient occlusion value is as simple as this one. But the ambient occlusion does not look right for some vertices. As you can see here, as we already mentioned, a square is actually two triangles. This subdivision causes anisotropy when interpolating colors in the fragment shader. To fix it is as simple as rotating the square to align correctly to the ambient occlusion when needed. The ambient occlusion value can be stored in 2 bits. With these new features, we are now using 90 bits in total, still 4 bits free remaining, but for now, they'll stay like that. And, by the way, I improved the smooth lighting, and now it's working completely fine. It's almost exactly the same technique used for ambient occlusion. Let's recap about some types of blocks that are currently in the game. On one hand, there are tickable blocks. These blocks have a defined behavior when they get ticked. And how do these blocks get ticked? They do when a neighbor block has changed its state. Previously, this tick request and handling was done in the main thread, and each chunk had its own list of tick requests. But this approach had some main inconveniences. A lot of unnecessary memory, lots of allocations and deallocations, slower iteration, as iterating over a list is slower than iterating through an array, and managing the tick requests in the main thread could freeze the game completely if there were a lot of ticks to handle. So obviously this had to be done in a better way. First, instead of using a dynamic list for each chunk, a global queue will be used. The main difference here is that the queue will not be dynamic. Its size will be fixed. Indeed, the queue is an array. Each element of the array will point to the next element by saving the index. The same will be done for the free slots. So we can easily find the free slots to push a new request or find the next request to dequeue it, without iterating over and over through all the array. The size of the array chosen is 55,536, so the index can be saved with only 2 bytes. So instead of having a list for each chunk, we have one array for the entire world that behaves like a queue. Now, the next issue to fix is the managing of the tick requests in the main thread to avoid freezes in the game. So I've created a thread specifically to handle the tick requests. This thread will iterate through the queue to manage all pending tick requests each 50 milliseconds. This way, in a second, there are 20 ticks. Well, we improved the periodic tick system. Could we do it with the other type of updates? The light updates can also be managed the same way. But I've created another queue only for the light updates. And also this time, instead of being a thread, it will be treated as a job, as we don't need this light update process to be running continuously. We'll schedule a job into a secondary available thread, only when a light update must be done. And that's mostly it for this devlog, apart from other small improvements and bug fixes. I hope you enjoyed this devlog and stay tuned for the new upcoming content. Thanks for watching and see you in the next video.